Hi there, I'm Peter Dykes and I'm the Associate Principal Oboe of the RSNO. Welcome to RSNO Principals Month, the month of March. I'm here with Chris Hart, our fantastic Section Principal Trumpet, and we're going to be talking about Chris, the trumpet, the orchestra, and the Haydn Trumpet Concerto that Chris is performing with the orchestra. So, Chris, great to see you. It's been a while. Yes. Fill us in about the Haydn Trumpet Concerto.
Okay, so this piece was really a seminal work for trumpet players because it was the first time that we could play anything chromatically. So pretty much, all string instruments at the time and the flute, and I think the oboe was on the go by then, and they could all play chromatically, so they could all play nice tunes. We were kind of limited to the harmonic series because the technology of the instrument hadn't progressed as quickly as everything else, so you get a very set sort of number of pitches. So it's kind of a note, and then an octave, and a fifth, and then a fourth, and a third, and then gradually get closer and closer together as you get higher up, which is why Bach wrote very, very high for trumpet players, because then he could write kind of tunes in lines rather than just doing things like fanfares. So when Haydn, the reason that Haydn came to write this piece was a trumpet player called Anton Weidinger had invented a new instrument. So instead of the natural trumpet, which was just one long sort of coil of metal, Weidinger had worked out that if you put holes in the pipe at a certain point and put kind of keys on them, it was a keyed trumpet, if you put keys on that vented air out of the instrument at certain points, that you could make all of the notes of the scale, which was amazing. That had never happened before. It works in a kind of in the opposite way to an oboe or a flute, where you put something down to make the note generally, whereas you sort of lift them off instead. But so Weidinger went to Haydn and said, I've got this instrument, it can play all the notes that anyone else can play, and I am very good at it, can you write me a concerto? And Haydn went, yeah, great, that sounds fantastic. So it starts off with the piece. You don't really suspect anything. I try and listen to it as though I've never heard it before. And it starts off with a big open bottom C, which is a fundamental note of the trumpet, which would have happened on a natural trumpet. You could easily do that. And then the next entry is a little fanfare, just a couple of beats long. Again, could easily have been played on a natural trumpet. So you don't really suspect where it's going. And then the rest of the orchestral introduction plays out, and you come in, and your first three notes are a C, a bottom C, a D, and an E. And the D was, up until the moment that Weidinger played that concerto for the first time, that note was completely impossible on a trumpet. It just didn't exist. So maybe it blew the audience's minds. I don't know. Maybe they weren't that easily amused. I've no idea. But from the very first entry, the first proper entry of the concerto, Haydn has sort of signposted it and gone, look what this instrument can do. Mm. And all the way through the first movement, there's chromatic scales showing off that you could do it. Because again, the audiences were not used to hearing anything like that from a trumpet. They were used to hearing something that was almost like another drum. You played C's and G's, and you played the cadences, apart from Bach's music, which was kind of over here. And so to have this instrument that can suddenly do so many things, and then it was amazing, and Hummel caught on to the fact that this instrument existed and wrote Weidinger the Hummel Trumpet Concerto, which is why we have these two concertos from that period. If Weidinger hadn't have invented this instrument, I don't know, who knows how little repertoire we would have had. We've not got a great amount of repertoire anyway compared to pretty much every other instrument, but the Haydn and Weidinger really kind of put a flag in the ground and said, this is what the trumpet can do. The keyed trumpet in itself wasn't great. It kind of sounds a little bit, well, certainly in my hands, it would sound absolutely terrible. It can sound beautiful, but they're very hard to play. And they certainly don't sound anything like this does. Just even the general quality of sound is nothing like a modern trumpet.
Wow, so it's a piece inextricably linked with the development of the actual instrument itself. Wow. And would the instrument of the day have been much different from the, forgive me if I get this wrong, from the piston trumpet that you've got there.
Yeah, that was very politically negotiated. I like that. This is an E-flat trumpet, so because the piece is in E-flat, but it was a keyed trumpet, so it would have looked a little bit like what a modern-day rotary trumpet would look like.
Right.
Except there's a series of keys, like on a saxophone, apart from you put keys down on an oboe or a flute or a sax to make the notes, whereas on a keyed trumpet, you open them.
Oh, okay.
So you create holes in the pipe at different points, yeah, and that vents air and creates all the chromaticism that you can get in the instrument. So they're very, very hard to play, and they don't sound anything like this or a modern trumpet, because it's like, you know, a Ford Model T is not as good as a Fiesta, because we've had, you know, 100 odd years to make them better. You know, it was like genesis of this kind of instrument.
Yeah.
And actually the key trumpet, they weren't great. They could do a lot more, and they sort of showed the potential, but I think there was only a couple of pieces, probably the Haydn and the Hummel, the most famous ones. But we really had to wait for the invention of these valves in sort of the late 1800s to kind of progress it any further, because it was kind of a novelty that everyone went, wow, that's kind of cool, and then just disappeared, because your oboes and your clarinets and a violin and a flute could already do much more, and it was much more appealing, and it sounded a lot better. So it kind of, the key trumpet kind of disappeared,
right,
for a while, and the trumpet repertoire went back to being C and G fanfares and that kind of stuff. So, yeah.
Wow. I mean, just winding back a little bit, thankfully, it doesn't sound anything like the saxophone. So we'll,
yes, I mean, I think we can all be grateful for that.
Well, that's amazing. And actually, if we're just thinking now, you know, in recent times with the RSNO digital season, you've been using some of the sort of historical looking instruments and things. And in general, you often play different instruments. Is that a choice that kind of you make stylistically, or does the conductor sometimes come in with an idea, how about this? Or indeed, is it specified by the composer on many occasions?
The composer, not usually. Sometimes with modern music, the pieces are much more kind of idiomatic, so that it might have been written specifically for a piccolo trumpet, for example, which you would be mad to do on a B-flat or a natural trumpet, because it just wouldn't work. A lot of the time, it's sort of up to us as a section, so I might say, do you fancy playing the rotary trumpets this week, or do you fancy doing Beethoven 7 on a natural trumpet? And then Thomas Sundergaard, he's quite keen on the natural trumpets, and he also likes the rotary trumpets that we got a couple of years ago, just after I joined. So it's kind of a combination, the same as anything else that we do, I suppose. Everyone kind of throws their ideas into the pot, and then whether it's me or Thomas that decides, actually, this is the most sensible thing to do for this week.
Right.
But I think it's quite nice. It's interesting playing the older trumpets with a modern orchestra, because I've done a couple of little things with the old trumpets, with strings playing like a classical pitch with sort of older instruments and gut strings and baroque bows and that sort of stuff, and it is a very different feeling, because these kind of trumpets are designed to project. They're all designed to throw their sound out as efficiently as possible, and old instruments aren't really, so you get that kind of zing without a lot of the dynamic. You can still play them loud if you want to, but you get that kind of sizzle on the top of the sound without having to. If I tried to play on a natural trumpet like I played this, people would just, hopefully people don't find what I'm doing offensive, but if I did the same on this, it would be pretty offensive, so.
Right, wow, yeah. Okay, one day I'll hear it.
Yeah. Okay,
but, you know, it's interesting you should say, because when we did those Beethoven symphonies, in recent months, we've been playing natural trumpet. I was looking forward to some comedy, but actually, as soon as I heard it, I thought, this sounds fantastic. It just seems to work really, really well. So it sounded great. And I was sort of like hoping for a bit of a calamity, but it was fantastic. Are you one of those trumpet players who drills the back bore of your mouthpiece?
No. Even in the last 11 months or so, it hasn't got to that stage. I haven't felt the need to do any of that. I just leave it as it is.
Right.
Because it's quite a deep rabbit hole that you can go down when you start kind of, it might not look like it, but there's a lot you can tinker with.
Right, I see.
On one of these. And if you start, you just never stop.
You never.
So I just Right. It's like picking away at a, it's like, oh, that's quite satisfying. But then it just keeps going, you know.
Now that I've mentioned it, are you going to go home and have a think about it?
Yes, I actually bought a lathe the other day. I'm going to get right on it. Yeah.
I can't wait. Can't wait to take a drill to this. Yeah. Interesting you should say about you about that, the modern instrument and projecting sound. This performance, of course, with a socially distanced orchestra, and it being you're not projecting sound over into a concert hall. It's into a microphone.
Yeah.
How is that experience? How was the experience? And B, how did it differ from sitting up in the principal trumpet chair?
Well, I mean, it might be hard to tell from where we're sitting at the moment. It's actually quite a long way from there, certainly to the conductor, who sort of sat another maybe 15, 20 feet that way. And normally you can deal with the distance okay, because our orchestra plays quite big repertoire, and so you're normally connected, so there'll be the back of the strings, and then there might be the old woodwind player in the firing line, but you actually feel connected to what's happening at the front. And I think the difference, certainly for me, has been that normally, watching the Friday Night Club videos, for example, you look at it and you go, wow, we're sat really close together. But of course, that's hopefully what we're going to go back to. But sitting this far apart from the next person, it makes it much harder to judge dynamic and timing, and especially like we struggled for the first couple of weeks being so far away and not having the sound close to us, because you're guessing how far ahead to play based on what you see and what you hear.
Wow, okay.
And if you get it slightly wrong, the conductor goes, trumpets, you're late.
Yeah.
Which is, as is their want, that's what they're there to do. But it sometimes it can make it quite stressful if you've got intricate things to play, because it can sound really, really terrible if you're not concentrating. Like the second you switch off, it's hopeless. But standing at the front, I found it much easier, because when you're playing the solo, there is an element that people sort of have to come with you, hopefully, you know. So, I mean, yes, you adjust to everyone else, but you go, this is the tempo that I've picked. This is the tempo that I'd like to play it at. So that it's a very different role. Normally at the back, we're very sort of subservient a lot of the time. We're kind of harmonic changes rather than anything melodically interesting. So we have to make sure that we're keeping the pace of the orchestra going as much as we can. Whereas when you're at the front, and if you're playing something with a melody, suddenly you've got that bit of license to kind of pull things around as you like.
Yeah.
So that it's quite different. I mean, I think everybody now has got used to the whole distancing thing, but for the first, I mean, the Mahler 7 that we did for the Edinburgh Festival in the summer, that was when the distancing was at its most extreme, because we wanted to be safe. Mm. So we thought, well, we'll do everything to the maximum that we can in the space available. So there's enough space between us that we know that it's as safe as it can be. But it was like I'd been sat on the naughty step in the corner, because I was sat right in the corner over there. And there was a harmonium that was only being used occasionally, and a piano that was only being used occasionally. So it was a good probably 30 feet to the next person, which you're not really used to. So it is a little bit disconcerting, but I think we're getting used to it now. Fingers crossed we won't have to be used to it for too much longer, but yeah, we'll see.
I was so socially distanced for that Mahler that I was still at home. one thing that does amaze me, we will get to the Haydn, back to the Haydn, is that in certain venues, let's say the Usher Hall, not only do you have distance that way, you actually have a vertical distance to take care of as well. You're miles up behind the rest of the orchestra. So it's amazing how you do it.
That's hard for balance as well, because if you think here, it's quite shallow.
Yeah.
So it can be raised up a lot higher. I think that the stage has been quite shallow for this stuff that we've been doing, which means that a lot of the sounds kind of gets absorbed into the people who are sat in front of you, sadly for them. But it does make balancing a little bit easier. Whereas when you're, the trombones especially, when it's a really big orchestra and they're sat pretty much in the choir stalls, they're sat probably, I don't know, maybe 8 or 9 feet above the people in the strings. So that anything they play just goes straight into the hall.
Yeah.
So a lot of the time the conductors will go, and they'll go, well, we're not doing anything different, but it's just because there's nothing in the way. Mm. They're just blowing into empty space, but it's all part of the charm, I suppose.
All part of the fun. I've been looking at some orchestras overseas where they've had to have the plastic screens actually between the players. That would be a whole different level again, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Have you performed this piece without a conductor at any point?
I've never done it unconducted. I did it with Sir Roger Norrington. Mm. I think it was probably my second season here. And I mean, he's great. He's such a massive character, you know, and it was great for me because he's very knowledgeable about, well, most music, but early music, kind of especially. And he gives some kind of real insights about the music and tempi and things that I'd thought about them, but you never, he's got such a wealth of knowledge that you can't really pick up in a short amount of time. You know, he's had probably 50 years of going around and thinking, oh, is that, maybe that's not right, maybe this is more appropriate, and testing it all out. So to have him there to go, oh, maybe you should think about doing it like this, or phrase this like this, or that bit like that, that might make it more effective and might make it more authentic even, was great. But I've never done it unconducted yet.
Right. There'll be a time. Probably when the relevant conductor can't get into the country due to travel restrictions, I don't know, something like
for
that.
For whatever reason, yeah.
Have you got, are there any, now of course, one thing I find fascinating is that, you know, you've been living with that instrument, you're incredibly highly skilled at the instrument, as are all the section principals in the orchestra. What are the kind of, there's obviously still, there's things in this piece which are still, you still find a technical challenge?
Yeah, I think the main thing for me is that what I was saying about the audience hearing it for the first time, you have to have that in your head, because I don't know if there's anything similar on the oboe, but the Haydn Trumpet Concerto is on pretty much every audition you will ever do, from pre-college, if you do your grade 8 before you go to college, it's on the grade 8 syllabus, and then all your college auditions, you'll have to play one of the, like the first or the second movement, depending on which colleges they are. And then once you're at college, you might audition to do it with a student conductor, or for the European Youth Orchestra, not that that'll probably happen anymore.
Yeah.
And then,
oh well.
Gustav Mahler Youth Orchestra, and then if you want to do a postgrad, it'll have to be a movement from the Haydn.
Yeah.
And then if you go to an orchestra, it'll be a movement from the Haydn. So for probably almost the best part of maybe 10 years, you'll be keeping the piece up and running constantly, because there'll always be an occasion to play it. And you can come to it and you'll be like, oh, God, I've got, I know we don't have a lot of repertoire, but there is more than this.
Yeah.
But, you know, the reason why it's chosen is because it's like, for me, it's like Mozart. You only ever notice it if it goes wrong. Mozart is beautiful. The second that something's out of place, it kind of, it draws your ear to it. And that's why I think people choose the Haydn, because it's got to be very, it's all got to be very kind of nailed down and sorted. And then you put the style on the top. You can try and put style on it as much as you like.
Yeah.
But if the sort of the groundwork isn't there, it's never very effective, which I think is why we play it so much. I mean, technical challenges, I think there's a few things, like there's a high B flat in the first movement, which often can draw the eye of you when you're looking at it. But if you just treat it like another note, it doesn't matter anymore. Like the higher trumpet players get very kind of tense about high notes, because they're the most important ones. The higher and the louder it is, the more important it is. Whereas if you just treat it as part of a line, suddenly, even if it goes wrong, it's like, well, maybe my middle B flat didn't quite speak, but I don't, you know, go and have a tantrum and give up because I've missed the middle one. But if you miss the top one, it's kind of, oh, it's terrible, but it's just another note. It's easy to say that. It's kind of persuading yourself to actually believe it when you're trying to do it. And the third movement, just little bits of kind of double tonguing and technical things where you just, again, you've got to make sure that it's all appropriate to the style of the music that you're playing. And that'd be one thing I think that I would maybe suggest if people were learning the piece, is that you'd listen to not just the Haydn Trumpet Concerto, but you listen to Haydn symphonies, or you listen to string quartets, or you get under the skin of how the composer writes his or her music. Because I think that's as important as anything, that the technical challenges can all be overcome with enough practice. But to get the actual kind of momentum and soul in the music, you need to know not just what this can do and what the piece can be. You need to know a bit more kind of outside that, I think.
Yeah. It's interesting you say. Obviously, some of these the content that we're putting together for these pre-concert talks is also aimed, you know, as you, for people studying the instrument. And one thing I really like about what you said there is it gives if you're a student learning the piece, this is an amazing insight into the other side of the table. This is the sort of thing that the panel is listening out for.
Yeah.
One thing that strikes me, having sat on audition panels, is all of that fantastic content that you've said, with a piece like this, which is so exacting, all of that content can be analysed in a very, very short space of time.
Yeah.
If you have a really kind of skilled panel listening to it. So, have you had any audition? What's been the shortest audition you've ever had with this piece?
It was the shortest and by quite a long way the most spectacularly embarrassing. I went to Paris to do an audition for Radio France. I think I was in third year undergrad. And I practiced and I got it up and they asked for it. It was quite strange. Normally in the UK, they specify that you play it on a B-flat trumpet, the normal one that you play in the orchestra. Mm. For this, I'm playing it on the E-flat because I think it's more of a solo instrument. Like if you heard Alison Balsam or Håkon Hardenberger playing it, they would play on an E-flat trumpet. In France, sometimes they can ask for it on a C trumpet, which is quite strange. It's a little bit, it makes it feel a little bit weird because you don't normally play it. Well, certainly in this country, you wouldn't normally play it on a C trumpet. So I practiced it and it was all fine and it was going well. And I started the audition and I walked in and there was a big sort of C shape of tables and there must have been maybe 18, what I imagine was all the principals plus a couple of extras watching, which is quite unusual. Like in this country, there might be four at the most people in an audition watching you. So I walked in, that was quite daunting, but I played and it was fine. And I got to the last phrase before the cadenza in the first movement. That bit. And the second valve in my C trumpet stuck halfway down. So it sounded a bit like this. I thought, oh, right, okay, that's not ideal, okay. But I thought, well, the trumpet player would have spotted that the valve stuck down because it had worked perfectly for the rest of it. And I got to the end and I played it and I sort of looked a little bit sheepish and, you know, let the kind of the tension ebb away. And then I said, would you like some excerpts? And they just went, no.
That's it.
So 3 days in Paris for four and a half minutes. Yeah. Yeah, so, yeah, 4.5 minutes of playing and 2 days and 23 and a half hours of thinking about what went wrong, which is great.
Wow.
But, yeah.
Amazing. I find overseas auditions, and this is sort of relevant if you're studying the piece, or especially if you're hoping to go and do music, which, of course, you know, the orchestral world is a global thing now. Mm. And it's only really in the UK where, bear with me, right, where if you're in the UK where the majority of the panel know how that instrument functions.
Yeah.
If you're playing, as you say, that to a large panel, let's say it's made up of 30 people.
Yeah.
Let's say, for argument's sake, 10 of those are brass players. That means you have 20 people listening to your audition.
You've got to convince them.
Who don't know how the trumpet works.
Do you know what? That leads me on to the best bit of advice I think I was ever given by any visiting professor. I can't remember exactly who it was, but I played something. Oh, I know. It was a French trumpet player called Eric Aubier, whose English isn't fantastic, but he's an absolutely brilliant player and a really fantastic teacher. And I was playing something, some kind of French, something like Tomasi or Jolivet or something like that. And I played something and absolutely clattered it, wrote it off. And I said, oh, sorry about that, that bit's really hard. And he said, they don't care. The audience don't care. They don't know whether it's hard or easy. They're not bothered. It doesn't matter whether it's hard. That's not the point. You know, like the same with the Haydn. There's bits in it that's hard, but who cares? If I'm listening to it, I don't go, oh, well, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, well, he missed it. It's like, well, that was terrible because it wasn't right.
Yeah.
They don't care that it might be the most difficult thing that's ever happened. They've come to hear you play it well, so play it well.
Yeah.
You know. Obviously, you've got to do the practice beforehand, but it's that kind of thing where that seems to be the switch from, like, before you go to college and then going to college. That's the kind of change in attitude where you go, yes, I am still learning, but I also have to show that occasionally I can perform it like I'm going to perform it, like in a class, if you have to do it in a performance class. There was a performance class that I played it probably in second year when I was studying in Cardiff, and I messed up the ending, and I put my instrument down, and my head of brass went, what are you doing? Why did you do that? I said, oh, well, I messed it up. He said, yeah, but you're performing it. It doesn't matter that we're, you know, your colleagues and a couple of teachers that are listening. That's not the point. This is a whole, this is a performance space. And if that happened in the, you know, St. David's Hall down the road, you wouldn't just put your instrument down and stop. So why are you doing it now?
Yeah.
You know, it's that kind of thing where it's the kind of switch up in, the dial up in pressure where you've got to go, this is what it's going to be like. Occasionally things will go wrong and you're going to have to deal with it. You know, so find a way to deal with it.
It's a great lesson in just the brutal truth of it in a way, because your teacher on a week-to-week basis can sort of like, it's a different kind of, it's not a clear like, okay, this is where
bang.
It's at.
Yeah.
You mentioned cadenza in the first movement there. Do you write your own cadenzas? Does one do that? Do you steal?
Yeah,
borrow, improvise?
For this, definitely not. I'm not cool enough to improvise. So I had written my own cadenza for it, but it was pretty pants. So for this one, I've actually done Maurice André's cadenza. And Maurice André, for anyone who doesn't know much about the trumpet, is pretty much the reason why we are able, as trumpet players, to stand in front of the orchestra. He legitimized in a massive way. I mean, he's got a discography it's unbelievable. For a trumpet player to have recorded all the stuff he recorded, and he performed worldwide, and this beautiful sound, and he's so musical for probably the best part of 40 years, I would have thought.
Wow. That's the gold standard there. There's no point. How do you improve on that?
Yeah.
Sort of thing. Yeah. Absolutely. Do you perform a lot from memory?
When I was at college, I tried to perform from memory if I could.
Yeah.
Since playing in the orchestra, I haven't done it as much because it's never really called for.
Mm.
Like I always used to try and learn my excerpts from memory for auditions and things. You'd always play with the part, but you'd have it in your head that if you can play it from memory, there's no reason why it should go wrong because it's ingrained in here.
Yeah.
I think solo playing is more effective when you're playing from memory because the very nature of a stand means that you look at that and you focus on it. Whereas if you take the stand away, it's almost like someone kind of lifts the, you know, like old cameras where they had had to go in and put the shroud over your head. It's almost like stepping back and taking it off. And then you're like, oh, there's violins and stuff that I can pay attention to. And it's quite freeing. Even with the piano, like I used to do a few recitals and things, and kind of stand in the well of the piano as much as possible, so you feel like you're part of the sound, rather than standing quite far away from it and sort of you're the trumpet and the piano's here. You kind of want to make it a little bit more of a homogenous thing.
Yeah.
And again, when you're, it's a little bit more difficult with the socially distanced thing because you know the violinist might be all the way at that wall and all the way at that wall, rather than quite close in and intimate. But you can still have that connection if you're sort of paying attention with your ears around the ensemble. So,
Of course, we now have orchestras like the Aurora Orchestra doing the whole orchestra is playing from memory.
Yeah.
Have you got any top tips or anything for students in terms of memorizing?
The way I used to memorize stuff is I used to find my favorite recording and play along with it.
Oh, great. Karaoke.
Pretty much, yeah. Because for me, it wasn't just about memorizing my own part.
Okay.
Again, it made me feel more comfortable if I knew what else was going on around me. Mm. So I just had a semi-decent pair of headphones that I'd put on and I'd sit there for, you know, if I was learning the first movement of the Haydn, I'd just sit there for whatever it is, 6 minutes at a time and play through it. And you'd listen to all the rests and you listen to all the interludes between the trumpet entries so that you've got it in your head, so that whether it's with the piano or with the orchestra, there's no surprises. There's nothing worse than getting there and you hear something and you go, oh, I wasn't expecting that.
Right.
Now what happens?
Yeah.
And then you sort of come out of the trance of playing and your brain gets involved and goes, you don't know what's going on.
that's a great way of doing it because you're learning it orally as opposed to just learning it like photographic memory.
Yeah. And you sort of do that as well because hopefully you've played it enough times and you break it down. The other side of the memorization thing was you break it down into manageable sections. So the listening thing is sort of when you've got it a little bit more in your head. and then you're stitching it together as a whole to actually memorize the dots, as it were. You break it down into small chunks and stitch them together slowly. That's pretty much how I practice everything, whether I'm memorizing it or not. If there's a hard bit, like if there's a hard passage of even like six beats in a piece where it's something technical, you split it down beat by beat, and then you add a note at a time so that you're always reinforcing the good things that you've done. Because a common thing that I see is like I used to hear this all the time when I was in college. You'd hear people practicing, not just trumpet players, you'd hear people practicing and they'd play something 10 times. 9 times out of 10, it was wrong. And the last time it was right, and then they'd stop and move on. So what they've done is they've reinforced the 9 times of variations of wrongness. Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, you might have learned a few things not to do.
Yeah.
But then you've got to the end and you're like, well, I've only done the right thing once. So my brain has got 10% of what's just happened has been right. In my head, it probably doesn't work like that, but in my head, that's kind of how I approach it. You think if that's the way you practice, you're always going to be less efficient than you want. So do it slowly and build it up slowly so that you don't make those mistakes time and again. Because the more often you make the mistakes, the more you're practicing making them. So
yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally. Absolutely. Yeah. I need to go and practice now. Oh, no. There's some fantastic insight there. Just a couple of nuts and bolts.
Yeah.
A student was coming to you with the Haydn Concerto, what edition would you...
So if I could, I would always try and find an Urtext edition for it, because it's like a blank canvas that you can put onto what you like rather than someone's kind of musical opinion. Yeah. The other one that's used by pretty much everyone is the Universal Edition. Yep. That's kind of the standard for auditions. You know, if you were to go to an audition that had a pianist provided, the pianist would almost certainly have a Universal Edition with them. So yeah, one of those two, I would say.
Yeah. Have you changed the piece as you play it, you know, in terms of, I don't know, articulations and that sort of thing over the years, or is it quite...
Not really, no. There are a few different ways that people play it.
Mm.
The very nature of it is kind of you play it how you like to play. So if I try to play it the way that somebody else liked to, it probably wouldn't be as effective because it wouldn't be what I wanted. That makes sense. That's kind of a lot of the battle in the orchestra, because we all have ideas of how we would like to play things, and that's a lot of the time that's kind of where the magic sits, I think, in orchestral playing, when you've got a conductor at the front who wants one thing and an individual musician who goes, well, I want to play it like this. What you're saying is wrong, but I'm still going to do it because that's what I'm being paid to do. So you've sort of got to park some of your musical instincts for a little bit and go, how can I do something that I like whilst making the person at the front happy?
Yeah.
You know?
As a very blunt, I heard someone say a very blunt sort of like version of that. So they're walking down the street with a violin, and this is a tutty violin player. Yeah. A member of the public walking past, oh, I see you're a musician. No, I'm an instrumentalist.
Oh, bang. Yeah.
Harsh.
Yeah, quite,
Any particular sort of recordings you'd recommend students to go and have a look look for? Or
There's a fabulous recording by Håkon Hardenberger. I think it's with the Academy of St. Martin in the Fields and Neville Mariner, which is terrific. In fact, I think that whole album is brilliant. Pretty much any recording by Maurice André. Really.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a few different ones knocking about, but they're all brilliant in their own way.
Yeah.
You know.
He was quite handy at stealing oboe concertos as well.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, massively.
Yeah,
you know. Well, a lot of the repertoire he stole was, again, because they had a piccolo trumpet, and he was going, well, this instrument can play roughly in the same range as some of the oboe. So some of the oboe concertos where the range is sort of compressed, it works perfectly because it goes high enough to sound impressive, but not too high that it goes off the top of the instrument, and it doesn't go low enough that you can't play it. So it's perfect, and it's nice repertoire that works quite well, I think.
And you don't have to make a reed.
Yeah, precisely. Yeah. You don't have to faff about with all that. So.
You know, all of that. You just have to drill your mouthpiece. Now, so now how long have you been in the orchestra now?
Ooh, what year are we in?
2021.
So it will be 4 years and a couple of months.
Wow. Great. Is there any particular kind of, any one highlight in that time?
We did a mile of six, mm-hmm. probably about 18 months ago, over. It was on Radio 3. And we did, I think, two performances. And it was absolutely electric. The orchestra was on great form. Some amazing things happened. And sometimes some of our audiences can maybe not quite like the big Mahler symphonies. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they get a little bit of a lukewarm reception, but it was so convincing. A Mahler 6 is quite a hefty sit. It's quite a long haul, even if you're sat playing. You know, you're thinking, oh, all right, there's only another 20 minutes to go. You know, so the fact that the audiences all stayed with us and the reactions were great, that was fantastic. And we also had, were you here when we did Bernstein Mass?
Oh, yes, yeah.
Where, I can't remember the guy who played the celebrant, he was fantastic in all the rehearsals, and he was really, because it's kind of musical theatre rather than orchestral stuff, sort of sit somewhere in the middle. And there's a scene in it where the celebrant is supposed to have a breakdown because he loses his faith. And all through the week, he never did it. I don't know whether you clocked that.
Yeah.
He never did that scene. He was like, no, I'm only going to do that in the show. And it was such massive forces. I think we only did it once, didn't we?
Yeah. Yeah.
We did it once in Glasgow because there was like a musical theatre chorus from the RCS and a rock band that had come with the conductor. And yeah, it was a massive thing. And this breakdown was utterly terrifying, and there were paths through the orchestra so that all the singers and musical theatre sort of actors could get on and off the stage, and he used them all, and he was sort of kneeling down at the feet of some of the string players, like begging them to help him because he was having this crisis of faith. And I was sat there, and it must have lasted for 5 or 6 minutes of him wandering around the stage having this meltdown, and you could feel everyone even in the orchestra was like, It was amazing. It was so good. Yeah.
When you say it was massive forces, that's the only time in the Royal Concert Hall in Glasgow where I've seen them have to take out audience seats to actually fit it in.
Yeah.
I assume it was pretty expensive to put on, I guess.
I don't know why we only did it once.
Yeah, I wonder. So I assume, and of course, you know, being principal trumpet, I assume that kind of the big repertoire is, that's what you enjoy the most. This orchestra does it so well.
Yeah, I mean, this orchestra is kind of quite full-blooded when it gets going, and when everyone's really going for it. I think when we went to the West Coast of America and did Prokofiev 5, I can't remember which venue it was, but there was one of them where the orchestra really clicked into gear. Like, it was great every night, but there was one that just really kind of, had a stressful coach journey, so everyone was, wanting to get going. But it's those kind of moments where when there's up to kind of 100, when there's up to kind of 100 people on stage and everyone's pulling in the same direction and you all, it almost feels like everyone's almost kind of thinking as one for that, whatever it is, 45 minutes.
Yeah.
It really is amazing. And again, because I get quite a lot of nice big tunes in the big pieces. And when you get to sit on top of that sound and just play it out, there's no better feeling. It's great.
Fantastic, and it sounds great as well. It is a pleasure to sit in front of you. There's a lot of trumpet players. It is not a pleasure to sit in front of, but for you, it absolutely is.
Text in the post.
Yeah, fantastic. of course, part and parcel of life in the RSNO is the chair patrons. Yeah. Quite a lot of players in the orchestra have chair patrons. I have one myself, fantastic chair patron. But your chair patron is Chris Hartness, which is quite amazing.
What
really
are the chances? We put a very specific advert out that said, is your name Chris Hart or approximately Chris Hart?
I mean, the history of chair patronage, or patronage in general, is Haydn had a patron himself, and
Esterházy.
Yes. So, I mean, what does that mean to you in terms of, a personal connection, or?
I think it's when it boils down to it, a lot of classical music for hundreds of years was people who liked classical music who had a bit of money spare, and they thought, well, I like this. Can I enable an ensemble or a person that I like to make good music? So when you sit there and you sit in the orchestra and you think, okay, so right, we're playing these big pieces and it's all great fun, but who are we actually affecting? What difference am I making to the world? And then when suddenly, when Chris came on board, must be nearly probably about a year ago now, it makes you realize that there are people out there who care incredibly deeply about what we're doing. Because you can sort of, I don't know whether you get this, when maybe not at the moment, because it's not normal, but normally it's quite sort of busy. You go from one thing to the next thing to the next thing, and you can get into a little bit of a rhythm of just kind of trudging through it if you're not careful. And you can lose sight of the fact that it does mean a lot to a lot of people. You know, I think one of our chair patrons, I think it's Catherine's, Lady Anne Smith, you know, she's a very busy lady, but she always makes time to get to the Usher Hall in time for the concert on a Friday night, because it means that much to her.
Yeah.
And the same with Chris, you know, she's supported classical music and music in general for quite a number of years. And now she's come on board, it does make you realize that, like I said before, that it just means that much. And it's quite sort of humbling when you sit there and you go, oh yeah, we are doing something good here. We're not just sitting and wasting our time.
Yeah, you know? There's like there and there is an actual like interface. It's amazing. Now, unique to this pre-concert interview, we're going to have a mastermind round to finish up on. Okay.
Yes.
This is the serious stuff. Okay. Right.
Is there a special chair somewhere?
Rapid fire answers.
Okay.
The fire alarm goes off during a rehearsal. You're only allowed to take either your instrument or your phone. Which do you take?
Phone.
When Alistair Mackie progressed from being a trumpet player in the Philharmonia Orchestra to chief executive of the RSNO, he turned one of his trumpets into a lampstand.
Yes, he did. Yeah.
What will you do with your instruments when you hang up the mouthpiece?
Oh, I don't know. I might do something cathartic. I know a lot of clarinet players like burn them, don't they?
Yeah, yeah.
They just make a big bonfire, which arguably is one of the best uses for a clarinet. But I don't know. I think I would probably, I might kind of flatten them so they're nice and artistic and then hang them on the wall.
Fantastic.
And like really hire a steamroller from somewhere else.
So what you're saying is it's probably good insulation.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If a principal trumpet were a position on a football pitch, where would you play?
Oh. What's a high risk position in a?
I don't know. You've got to be the playmaker in the middle.
Yeah, number 10.
Number 10, flair. Yeah. Which would sound better, the Haydn trumpet concerto played on a trumpet or a flugelhorn or a cornet or a tenor horn?
A tenor horn.
There's evidence that in the rehearsals for the first performance, Anton Weidinger had a few questions about some details in the score and the conductor as well and the orchestra. So during a break in rehearsals, they thought they would go and find Haydn to get some clarity on a few of the details, but they couldn't find him anywhere. They looked all around the building, and there's just no evidence of him anywhere. Do you have any idea why that was?
No, I didn't.
Well, because the composer was Haydn.
I'll stop now. I can't believe I went along with that.
Yeah, I know. Chris, it's been great to have a chat with you and great to get insight.
What a way to end.
Yeah, I know. insight into the instrument, life in the orchestra, performing the concerto, and some fantastic tips for people hoping to learn the piece. You're going to have a fantastic time watching the concert. We all had a great time recording it. This is the RSNO Principals Month, and Chris Hart, Section Principal Trumpet. Thank you very much.
Thank you.